Now we would like to, before President Clinton comes up to the stage, mention briefly that the award that President Lagos and Prime Minister Kok will be presenting is called the Club of Madrid Democratic Leadership Award. It was previously given to President Nelson Mandela, and it was designed by a very prominent Spanish artist named José Manuel Ballester. And I want to briefly just mention a few words as he described this award, which he specifically designed for President Clinton. And he said that the pinnacle of human existence lies within the framework of a free society. It's a society that respects civil rights and does not hinder the personal and social development of its members. However, we can find societies in this world that fear freedom and raise insurmountable barriers. These barriers are the walls that thwart the development of mankind, limit its existence, and block its path. This is the idea that inspired my work, and I hope, and we hope, President Clinton will see the genius that went into this particular prize. And with that, I would ask President Clinton to come to the stage to accept the award.
Thank you very much, Tim, Prime Minister Kok, President Lagos, Jose Maria, thank you all for being here. Thank you for the award. In general, I have never believed that former American presidents should receive any awards. I thought the job was honor enough, but for me, this is a special night because I believed in the Club of Madrid from the beginning, and I am thrilled at the work that has been done in these last fast passing years. I'm glad to see so many of my friends and people with whom I served here at the New York Public Library. And just, it's a beautiful place, isn't it, the New York Public Library? I'll tell you a great story. I was thinking, we've all been thinking a lot about Greece lately. But I promised the Prime Minister of Greece, as a big supporter of the attempts of the country to uncover and carefully nourish all of their archaeological treasures, that I would make a pitch to the then Prime Minister of the UK, Tony Blair, who was my very good friend, that he should return the Elgin marbles to Greece. And so Tony looked at me and he said, "I will do it as soon as you get the New York Public Library to give the Magna Carta back to the British Museum." So, and I said, "Tony, I live in a democracy where the president's powers are limited. One of those limitations is that on that score, the New York Public Library is more powerful than the president of the United States. But it's a great honor for me as an American to welcome all of you here tonight to the city where I have my office now. I live just about 20 miles north of here, and to this library, which has meant so much to many generations of New Yorkers and to people all over the country. I also want to say a little bit about what I think the significance of the Club of Madrid is after 10 years. And I want to say a special word of appreciation to all of you who have given financial support to the work of the Club of Madrid. The very fact that we exist is a testimony to the power of democracy and freedom. Because all of us were once in office, we're still of sane mind and body, and no one had to shoot us to get us to leave. And yet, we didn't want to gather dust. We wanted to be of some use. So we all find ourselves all of a sudden in the non-governmental movement. I remember about 3 months after I had been out of the White House, I was finally beginning to get my bearings. I was totally lost for the first 3 or 4 weeks because for the first time in 8 years, when I walked in a room, no one played a song anymore. They always play this song when a president walks in the room. And I was shaving one morning and I looked in the mirror and I thought, my God, I have become an NGO. And so have we all of us who are part of the Club of Madrid. But the impact that you have may be bigger than you know. Not very long ago, a friend of mine invited me because of my long involvement in the Balkans with Bosnia and Kosovo and Macedonia and other countries to come to Buda, the oldest port of Macedonia, where the old city wall goes back 2,800 years. And he had invited the sitting and former presidents and prime ministers of countries all over southeastern Europe to come. There were 12 people there with whom I had served. In the area where I was told when I became president would be my biggest headache, all they wanted to do was fight, there would never be a peace, there would never be a reconciliation, everything was a blood feud, and democracy was a fool's errand. There were 12 of them from all over the Balkans, all of whom had served honorably and left office either under term limits or electoral defeat or voluntary relinquishment, and they all were still committed to building their countries, to building the region, to being a part of civil society. It is something that you can all take heart from. And they, every one of them knew what the Club of Madrid was and what it had been doing. I am honored that you gave me an award that you first, quite properly, gave to Nelson Mandela, who has been my friend for 20 years. When I started the bulk of my foundation work, it began with him. We were closing the International AIDS Conference in 2002 in one of my favorite cities in the world, Barcelona. And at the time, there was no PEPFAR, the American program to fund AIDS and malaria care. The Global Fund had been established, and we organized it in my last year as president. Then it was brought up in 2001, but it had not been funded. So Mandela and I were still part of an informal group of former heads of state and government that were basically going around rattling the tin cup for AIDS money to the people we served with who were still in office and actually had money to dispense. So after we did this event, the man who, ironically, is still the Prime Minister of St. Kitts and Nevis, one of the most beautiful countries in the Caribbean, who is a medical doctor, came up to me and said, Bill, we have no denial problem. We have no stigma problem. But the Caribbean does have the second fastest growing rates of AIDS in the world. I said, well, what's your problem? He said, we have a money problem and an organization problem. And I looked at him, I said, well, Denzel, what do you want me to do about it? He said, I want you to fix it. At the time, I had 12 employees, and I had to raise $100 million to build my library and museum. And I looked at him like a fool and said, okay, I'll do that. And I had really no idea where to begin. And thanks to the early help I got from Canada and Ireland and then Norway and other countries, we were able to start this AIDS project, which now does provide medicine off our contracts to 4 million people in the developing world. That's about half of all the people who get the medicine, including 75% of all the kids. I say that because there is so much we can do. But the unique gift that the Club of Madrid has is that it is an NGO that believes in government, believes in the promise of government, and understands that an NGO basically is good for two things. The thing that NGOs have done from the beginning. America's first NGO was organized by one of our founding fathers, Benjamin Franklin, who in Philadelphia organized a volunteer fire department before the United States had a constitution. Why did he do that? Because there was not a sufficient tax base in Philadelphia to hire city employees to be in a fire department, and because not enough places burned down on a regular basis to make a living putting out the fire and charging people for it. So we stepped into the gap between what the public sector could provide and the private sector could produce. All over the world there are such NGOs trying to hold the fabric of society together, and they're very important. But in the modern era, the NGO has taken on a whole new slant, trying to help take on problems and help others to solve them faster, less expensively, and better. And if you think about it, we're very well, especially the Club of Madrid, we're well suited for that. Unlike the private sector, we don't have to turn a profit or try to every quarter. And unlike our colleagues who are still in office, we don't have to be embarrassed or if we fail. We don't have to worry about a bad news story. We can say, we tried to do this, it didn't work. Now we'll go do something else. And that is very important today because of the role of governance. Think about it. The financial crisis was caused by a failure of governance in America, which then spread elsewhere to other places where there had been a failure of governance, principally allowing too much risk to be taken with too little capital to back it up. Over-leverage, there are many different permutations, but when you get right down to it, that's what causes every financial crisis. The current problems in Europe are in part a function of what I applauded Helmut Kohl and Jacques Chirac and the others when they formed the Eurozone and issued euros, but it was obvious to everybody who was thinking about it that for the poorest countries and the countries that had the most atypical economic and political systems, the euro was going to be a great run when things were growing because people would get investment they otherwise couldn't get and would be part of a bigger market than they would otherwise be a part of. But when things went downhill, if there were uniform austerity measures, the poorest countries would be in real trouble.